Hello everybody, let us start with the another module of crystal plasticity and crystal plasticity. That is the hardening mechanism in metals. So actually this topic is significant to analyze what the typical mechanism exist to explain the specifically the hardening behavior of the material. So this module will try to focus on the specific topic on the deformation of polycrystals, structure strengthening, that means presence of structure, is there any strengthening effect on the microstructure or not, what is the effect of the crystal structure and grain size to impart the strength in the metal itself, then strain hardening, solid solution strengthening, dispersion strengthening, precipitation hardening. These all are the typical hardening mechanism actually exist in the metals, and that mechanism, using that mechanism specifically, we try to explain that imparting the strength level or increasing the strength level of a specific material, and specifically all these are subjected to when try to explain in the specifically in the plastic deformation zone of a material. So individually we will try to focus on the that individual topic, but to do that, what are the basic philosophy that how to increase the strength of a material. So we start with the mechanism of the slip, or maybe we try to link with the dislocation, slip, all this typical elementary term we use in the plastic deformation of a material. So first is the slip of dislocation actually weakens the crystal. So then what are the way to strengthen the crystal or material? There are two possible ways. Probably first one is the, if it is possible to completely remove the dislocations, then in absence of dislocation the strength level may be more in case of crystals or materials, but practically it is very difficult as dislocations can be generated during the deformation. So ideally it is not possible to exactly on a specific structure defect free, that means dislocation defect free. Another option is that increase resistance to the motion of the dislocations, or if it is possible to put obstacles to the motion of the dislocation that actually impart the strength or increase the strength level for a single crystal structure or polycrystalline structure, or in general it is in metals or materials. So there are basically different type of strengthening mechanism we explain, and of course in this case we will try to focus on that mostly in case of single crystal structure, and we using in a single crystal structure how the strength can be increased of a structure looking into the different mechanism. So there are basically four mechanism. One is the solid solution strengthening. Solid solution strengthening means it's a simply by adding interstitial and substitutional alloying elements. So always this strengthening mechanism, that means with respect to the pure metals, if there are it is possible to add some alloying elements to the material, then in general that actually impart the some amount of the strength, and that is called the solid solution strengthening. And second one is that cold working. Cold working means if you try to deform the material and there is a increase of the point defects, and there is of course increment of the dislocation density, number of dislocations, and if there is a number of dislocations and that the increase of the number of dislocation actually impart, but not simply increment of the number of dislocation and their interaction with each other, probably increase the amount of the strain, and that mechanism is called specifically cold work, due to the cold work. Another is the decrease in grain size. So within the microstructure itself, it is possible to decrease the grain size. That means fine grain size actually produces more amount of the strength as compared to the coarse grain structure. So only difference is that in fine grain structure, the number of grain boundaries actually increases, and that grain boundary actually resist the dislocation motions, and by that mechanism we can increase the strength by decreasing the grain size. So this is generally called, typically called Hall Patch hardening mechanism. Fourth one is the precipitation or dispersion hardening. That means in general, if it is possible to introduce some precipitates or inclusion in the path of the dislocation motion, which actually impede the motion of the dislocation. So here actually we try to explain all this typical mechanism of strengthening of a single crystal structure, and that actually in broadly we can say all these cases there is a obstacles of the dislocation movements. With this mechanism we can increase the strength level of a single crystal structure. So usually there will be the other sources of opposition or some obstacles to the motion of the dislocations in the material. What are the other sources? So presence of the stress field of other dislocations. So stress field of other dislocation actually impart some amount of obstacles to the movement of the dislocation. Stress field from low angle grain boundaries, presence of the grain boundaries, effect of the solute atoms and vacancies, presence of the stacking faults and twin boundaries all actually contribute, or maybe all actually responsible to increase the strength level by obstructing the motion of the dislocation. So some of these barriers probably we can categorize is like that, short range obstacles, which is the short range obstacles that can be overcome by thermal activation, but that thermal activation is may not be applicable for the long range of obstacles. So let us look into that, categorize into whether short range or long range obstacles like that. So finally all these factors actually contribute to the strengthening of a material. Now obstacles to the motion of a dislocation, one is that long range internal stress field. So how is it like that? A thermal process which is not involved either heat or change in temperature, that means the thermal, it is not thermal activated process. So in this case the shear stress is actually not the function of the temperature and strain rate, and this arises from the long range internal stress field due to the stress field of other dislocation or due to the presence of incoherent precipitates. So with the long range of internal stress field, and now we see that what are the short range of obstacles, and that obstacles for the motion of a dislocation. Thermal process, if it is thermally activated process, in that case the shear stress is a function of the temperature and strain rate. And short range means we assume the range which is equivalent to the 10 atomic diameters with specific crystals, atoms of specific crystal structure, and actually temperature can help dislocation overcome these obstacles. But in case of the sources, probably the stress field of the coherent precipitates and other solute atoms can be considered as a short range of obstacles for a dislocation movement. So overall we can divide the obstacles to the motion of a dislocation. It can be in the range of the long range or it can be in the short range of obstacles. So let us look into that, how actually impart the motions to the dislocation helps or resist to that motion. Now, what is the effect of the temperature on this dislocation motion? One thing is that motion of a dislocation can be assisted by the thermal energy. However, the motion of dislocation by pure thermal activation is random. It is not very certain that if thermal activation is there, definitely all type of short range obstacles can be overcome. That means the thermally activated process to against the resistance of the dislocation moment is purely random. So that means there is a probabilistic way we can estimate what is the amount of the dislocation obstacles can be overcome by application of the temperature. If we look into that, a dislocation can be thermally activated process to cross the potential barrier, if we define Q, which is generally called the activation energy, to the neighboring metastable position. Now, strain rate can be related to temperature and temperature T and this Q, which is called activation energy. Now, this thermal activation actually reduces the yield stress or flow stress, because this thermal activation actually reduces the resistance to the dislocation motion, and by that way it actually reduces the amount of the flow stress or yield stress value. Materials which are brittle at room temperature probably may also become the ductile at very high temperature, because at very high temperature the more slip system may be active, or maybe it can accommodate large amount of the plastic deposit for a fixed amount of the application of the stress. So the strain rate, temperature, activation energy can be linked this way. The strain rate equal to some constant e to the power minus q by kt. So Q is the activation energy, T is the temperature. So these are the typically relation of the thermally activated process between the strain rate, temperature and the activation energy, where strain rate is defined d epsilon by dt. So overall we can say that temperature is having some effect to reduce the motion of the dislocation which during the plastic deformation of a specific crystal structure. Now, what are the other way, that means how dislocation can interact and what are the typical mechanism is called for the hard, that impart the strength for a specific single crystal structure. So one is that dislocation interaction, how the interacting with each other with respect to the other dislocation, probably that is called strain hardening mechanism. When dislocation interaction happens with respect to the grain boundaries, then we can say the grain boundary strengthening. Actually, the presence of the grain boundary creates some obstacles to the motion of the dislocation. Third, when the dislocation interaction with the solute atoms, that we can say the solid solution strengthening, and then interaction with the precipitates, then we can say the precipitation hardening, and dislocation interaction with the dispareoids, then which we can call is the dispersion strengthening mechanism. So all these typical mechanism exist, and here we will try to explain all these typical mechanism how the dislocations actually interact with the different phenomena with respect to other dislocation, with respect to grain boundary, with respect to the presence of the solute atom, in presence of the precipitates, in presence of the dispareoids. So all these mechanisms are actually active, or all these mechanisms in general is effective to impart the strength of a single crystal structure. Now in general, the hardening mechanism, or maybe strengthening, we can say the strengthening mechanism in metals is basically explained in such a way that the strength of the metals is actually very much sensitive to the microstructure. So hardening mechanism exists that can be said that dislocation motion becomes more difficult in general, we can say, or maybe strengthening mechanism reason for that is the mechanism is in one in is a simply we can say that the dislocation motion becomes more difficult, that actually impart the strength or hardening mechanism to the single crystal structure or polycrystal structure in general in metals. So decreasing grain size, that means that is more related to the more grain boundaries to impact dislocation motion. Strain hardening actually increases the number of dislocations and also interferes with respect to each other, and that with the number of dislocation actually with that mechanism actually it this mechanism is generally called the imparting the strain by the mechanism of the strain hardening. Solid solution hardening, solute atom disturbed the periodicity of the lattice or presence of the solute atoms in an alloy as compared to the pure metal actually impart some amount of the obstacles to the dislocation motion. So these are also that is called the solid solution hardening or solid solution strengthening mechanism. Dispersion of the fine particles basically creates obstacles to the dislocation motion in the presence of the fine particles, and that presence of the fine particles actually impart some amount of the obstacles to the dislocation, and this mechanism is called the dispersion strengthening mechanism. So all these typical strengthening mechanism, we'll try to explain the each and every mechanism one by one. So first we'll try to look into that. Before that, we can say that the martensitic formation and strain aging in steels are also considered the separate mechanisms, so which is not in the same class, which we have classified the strengthening mechanism or hardening mechanism measures. We excluded the martensitic formation and strain aging effect in steels. Other factors that affect the strength, basically the constraints from the neighboring atom, neighboring grains in case of polycrystalline structure, and of course the preferred orientation and type of the crystal structure is the another affecting factor that actually brings or that actually influence the strength of a microstructure or single crystal structure. So we have this already discussed the Taylor factor, and this M is defined as the Taylor factor, and here figure actually represents the orientation dependence of M, the Taylor factor, for FCC undergoing axisymmetric deformation. Actually these factors or individual contour is comes that depending upon the orientation of the application of the load or orientation of the different orientation of the slip. So here we consider the along the three specific axis 100, 110 and 111. In this three axis we consider as a corner point of a triangle, and within this triangle if for the different direction the deformation behavior we are trying to the deformation behavior may not be the same in between these three directions, and we are plotting that orientation dependence of this deformation represented by these three triangles, and we try to represent the variation of all these things, all this in terms of the contour plot. So basically this isocontour, the variation from this point to that point, it is basically that represents 3.5, 3.6, these are the simple number that represents the isocontour between the two axes. So that orientation dependence of the M we have considered, and most of the cases when you try to analyze the behavior of the polycrystalline material, probably we can consider the average value of M, and in that case we estimate the relation between the shear stress strain of a single crystal structure with respect to the polycrystalline structure. And in this case this actually orientation dependence of this Taylor factor actually is very much effective when we have the deformation behavior of the polycrystalline structure, and by looking into the average value of the M we can produce the deformation behavior or the stress strain curve of a single crystal structure. But tension test for the randomly oriented polycrystal for FCC, and for this case we need to define this Taylor factor M, and orientation dependence M or FCC crystal structure is represented here that m is the ratio of the shear stress by the normal stress by the shear stress component. So axisymmetric deformation, here we have mentioned that is equivalent to the tension test of a randomly oriented polycrystal. So looking into the concept of this using the Taylor factor, probably we can use to explain the hardening behavior here, that is called the structure strengthening mechanism. Structure is the distribution of the crystallographic orientation of a polycrystal sample, and that is better explained by the pole figures. So I am not focusing on that pole figures here, but just to idea about this thing, the structure strengthening. Here most of the polycrystal have crystallographic structure, so orientation probably in one direction. There is a crystallographic orientation we generally consider. The grains are not randomly oriented in that case, if you consider this thing, and some grains are probably most favorably oriented for the slip system than with respect to others. So this orientation of the grains with respect to the slip direction or their difference probably brings some amount of the strengthening in the single crystal, in the deformation of a polycrystalline structure. Since some grains may be more favorably oriented and some grains may not be, so that is the structure is having some influence on the strengthening mechanism. So it is observed that the Schmidt factors for most of the most and the least favorably oriented single crystal in FCC and BCC actually differs by the factor 2. Just approximately factor 2, if you see that M along the direction 111 for FCC, the resolve factor M actually vary between 0.5 to 0.27. So ratio is approximately 2. For BCC structure, for the same direction, the ratio it varies M from 0.5 to 0.314. So there is a huge variation of this. M can vary depending upon the application of the slip system or slip direction, or application of the which direction the load is acting. So here M is the Schmidt factor, and we represent M equal to cos phi cos lambda. So here the significant point is that the M actually varies over a wide range. So in FCC and BCC probably it is near about 2. There is a huge variation of these things. So this variable can be used to represent the mechanism of the structure strengthening. So orientation dependence figure can be used to predict the strength of a structure FCC polycrystal undergoing axisymmetric deformation. For example, for wires or fiber structurings along 1-1 direction, M can be considered as the value of 3.67. But wires with the 1-0-0 fiber structure, M can be 2.45. That means if orientation of the single crystal, if orientation is more favorably oriented along 1-1 direction, or if orientation is along 1-0-0 direction, in these two cases, the values of the Taylor factor is, if you see, there is a difference in the Taylor factor. So actually, and this difference of the Taylor factors presents because of the structuring in specified direction. So that means structure actually affects the yield loci, and probably this presence of the structure is the bring some not exact anisotropic plastic behavior in the deformation of a polycrystalline structure. If we observe for HCP metals, for HCP crystal structure metals, the crystallographic structure has a very large effect on yielding. So on yielding, it is having very huge effect, since the Schmidt factor, that means M for basal slip plane actually varies with orientation from 0.5 to 0. So that means there is a huge variation due to the presence of the structure in HCP crystal structure, where the m varies actually 0.5 to 0. So with these variations, there is a variation. So that signifies that the presence of the texture actually impart, presence of the consideration of the structure or presence of the structure is basically impart some amount of the strength in case of the crystal structure. So if we consider the plastic behavior of the material, specifically polycrystalline materials, it's necessary to consider the effect of the structuring, and the presence of the structuring actually brings some anisotropic behavior of the polycrystalline structure. So in that sense, if we plot the stress strain curve for cold rolled zirconium, if we see that the if it is several rolling direction, that this curve actually represents the rolling direction. So we are trying to explain the rolling process here, and if you see there is a stress versus true stress versus true strain curve. We see this is the rolling direction, but transverse direction, if you see the transverse direction, the second figure and the third figure is the true thickness direction. So we observe in a rolling process that three different directions, there are stress strain behavior are completely different. So probably with this deformation, with this deformation behavior and the presence of the structure in this specific structure, probably the strengthening effect is more in the true thickness direction. So in this case, actually the basal plane is oriented parallel to the plate, causing the strength in the true thickness direction to be the much higher than that in the direction in the plate. So message is that presence of the structure one specific direction probably impart some strengthening mechanism with respect to the amount of this other direction. So true thickness direction, here in this case the true thickness direction is the more amount of the strength is produced, and this happens due to the presence of the structure which is oriented parallel to the plate. Now definitely the presence of structure also affects the isotropic behavior of the metal structure. If we see the yield loci of a texture sheet of titanium alloy, the figure represents that yield locus of a titanium alloy. Here see that isotropic behavior and anisotropic, this curve actually represents the anisotropy behavior, and you see the strength in plane strain is about 40% greater than that uniaxial tension. So on the plane strain, in case of the plane strain condition, the strength is 40% greater than that of uniaxial tension, and see, and that happens due to the presence of the amount of the structure, and that anisotropic, we see the strength level is very high, or yield locus is more as compared to the isotropic behavior of the material, and that is because of the presence of the structure. So with this effect of the strengthening due to the presence of the structure in a crystal structure, now we will try to focus on that mechanism because of the crystal structure. So differences in the crystal structure also bring some amount, also brings the difference in the strength level. Let us look into that. First, crystal structure actually strongly affects the hardness and the yield strength. Mainly happens on that strongly. FCC metals have generally higher strength than BCC and lower strength than HCP structure. So FCC, but hardness changes when the metal transforms. That is the more important, from one crystal structure to other. So the allotropic transformation, in this case the general trend of the decreasing hardness is interrupted alpha to gamma, so two different phase transformation at 910 degree centigrade for pure iron. So if you see the figure, that actually at this temperature 910 degree centigrade, for pure iron the crystal structure changes from BCC to FCC. So at this zone BCC is actually BCC to FCC. So at this zone BCC structure is softer, due to greater number of the slip system. We know that in BCC structure there are 48 slip system, but in FCC structure there are 12 slip system. Probably that is the reason for that. BCC is the softer and FCC is the harder. FCC import more amount of the strain, particularly at this temperature when there is a transformation happens from BCC to FCC structure in case of pure iron. Similarly, if we consider the another example, that hardness of the titanium actually sharply drop when it transforms from HCP structure to BCC structure, because there are few slip system in HCP crystals. Probably the slip system is very number of, it's very less as compared to the BCC structure, and that actually observes in the titanium alloy. So here we can say that crystal structure actually brings crystal structure and the presence of the different slip system also responsible to differentiate in the strength level, to differentiate the change of the hardness or change of the strength level can also be observed in case of the different type of crystals, and that is more or less related to that transformation at a specified temperature when it transforms from one typical crystal structure to the another structure, because during the transformation one structure to another structure system, so there is a difference in the slip system in this case, and that difference in the slip system impact whether there is a increment or whether there is a decrement of the hardness or strength level for a specific crystal structure. So after discussing on the effect of the crystal structure on a strengthening mechanism, now we shift to that effect of the grain size and how it can be presence of the grain size, how the grain size can be linked with the strength of a single crystal or polycrystalline structure. In early stage of deformation, actually the grain boundaries creates the obstacles to the slip system. Fine grain materials are stronger than that of the coarse grain structure only because of that. In fine grain structure, the total grain boundary area is more as compared to the coarse grain structure, and when there is a grain boundary area is more, probably that creates more amount of the obstacles to the dislocation movement. So this, the relation between the strength and grain size probably better explained by the Hall patch relation. Here if you see what is that relation, sigma y, sigma u is basically yield stress, and maybe you can represent in the yield stress in the SI unit, Newton per meter square. Sigma 0, actually the stress to move or dislocation in a single crystal structure. So that is the amount of the stress required, that is the fixed amount of the stress required to move the dislocation, and that is sigma 0, that is represents the Newton per meter square, and the ky is the locking parameter, measure of the relative hardening contribution of the grain boundary. So it is basically constant term we use, and depending upon the type of grains, and d is the grain size or grain diameter. So these are the very important equation we generally relate the yield stress value in terms of the grain size. Now what are the typical mechanism for the increment or strain in the presence of the grain or presence of the grain boundary? So actually the dislocation piles up at grain boundaries, and of course the dislocation piles up at the grain boundaries, and this number of dislocations in the pile up is actually proportional to the grain size, that is grain diameter d. But the stress concentration in the grain across the boundary actually increases the number of dislocations in the pile up, and hence the grain size. So the number of dislocations in the pile up is responsible to increase the grain size, and a larger grain size, a lower applied stress is required for sleep. And the depend similar way, the dependence of the hardness can also be relate with respect to the grain size, H equal to H0. And with a similar philosophy, when you try to relate the strength to the grain size, and here H0 and HK are constant terms. Now, more fact on the grain size, relation between grain size and the strength, we can say that for coarse grain material, the strength depends additionally on the ratio of the grain size to the specimen size. When there is a coarse grain structure, the apart from the motion to the dislocation movement, the strength level actually depends on the ratio of the grain size to the specimen size. So let us look into that fact that in grains at the free surface, the deformation is less constant by neighboring grains than interior grains. So the deformation level on the surface grains is different from the deformation level of the interior grain for a specific sample. And that actually influences the strengthening mechanism. In that way, that surface grains actually do not require exactly the 5 active slip system. So lower stress is necessary for the deformation. So low amount of the stress can deform the surface grains as compared to the interior grains of a sample. Therefore, the overall strength can be represented, or the volume fraction of the surface grains can be represented like this: sigma equal to Vf sigma s plus 1 minus Vf sigma I. So proportionate way, if it is possible to estimate the volume fraction of the surface grains as compared to the interior grains, so we can estimate the overall strength of a sample, and that actually depends on the amount of the surface grains, or basically the amount of the surface area presence in the specific sample. So this is the stress for the surface grain, and this is the stress level for the interior grain, and we can multiply this the proportionate percentage of the volume fraction. So as sigma x and sigma I are stress necessary to deform the surface and interior grains, Vf is the volume fraction of the surface grains. So since volume fraction of the surface grains, so volume fraction of the interior grain, it will be 1 minus Vf. So if we consider the tensile specimen with a circular cross section, in this case we can roughly estimate the volume fraction is pi by 2 d by d, so ratio capital D is the specimen diameter and small d is the average grain size. So this volume fraction depends on this ratio, and we can estimate the overall strength. But the estimation is reasonable if at least d less than, the diameter is less than 1/5 of the specimen diameter, then this approximation is applicable. Let us look into that one example. Let us see d by d equal to 1/10. So in this case we can estimate the volume fraction by approximation of pi by 2 into d by d. So in this case we can roughly estimate, if d small d by capital D is 1/10, probably in this case it is approximately 0.16. so we can find out that 0.16 into that stress value for the surface stress, and this is the stress value for the interior grains. So this is the typical estimation of that. But if we consider the flat sheet specimen, in this case the volume fraction can be roughly estimated that pi d by t, where t is the thickness of the specimen. So that volume fraction depends on the grain size and the sheet thickness ratio. So these are the typical calculation we can show, that the effect of the grain size, or to link between the grain size and the strength level And we use the Hall Pitch equation also to relate the strength of flow stress value in terms of the grain, average grain size, or similar we can relate the hardness of a material in terms of the average grain size, that follows a similar kind of relations. Now we'll try to focus on the strain hardening mechanism, how this mechanism impart the strength to a specific structure or specific single crystal structure or polycrystalline structure. So basic mechanism for the strain hardening is that during the deformation there is an increment of the dislocation. So there is a dislocation generation, and dislocation density actually increases with the deformation of the material. So that increment amount of the dislocation impart the strength. Let us look into some physical data on that. So dislocation density of an annealed material probably in the normalities range in the 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 9. But with the application of the cold work, that means if we try to deform that sample, then the dislocation density increases 10 to the power 12 to in the range of 10 to the power 14. So the increment of the strain, the second when there is an increment of the dislocation density, this becomes more stronger material as compared to the annealed material what. So that defense set we can bring in terms of the dislocation density. There is an increment of the dislocation density. Now, if dislocation were to leave the surface of the crystal by slip or glide, then the dislocation density should decrease on plastic deformation. But observation is contrary to this. So if you look into that, so up to when you just start on the plastic deformation, beyond that, there is a due to the strain hardening mechanism, there is an increment of the dislocation density, and that actually impart the amount of the strain to the material. So this implies some source of the dislocation, multiplication or creation should exist. So because of that, the dislocation generation mechanism, there is a we know that there is a Frank Reed source of dislocation generation. So that means with the further cold working on the material, that or with the deformation of the material, there is an increment of the dislocation density, and that dislocation density actually the interaction between them, or that dislocation density as a bulk, some amount to impart the movement of the dislocations more difficult, and that is responsible to increase the strength. So that is increase the strength due to the mechanism of the strain hardening. But what are the source of the dislocations? So it is difficult to obtain crystals without dislocation. So it is difficult to obtain the making crystal without the presence of making any if you consider only single grain. It is difficult to presence or difficult to produce the grains without any dislocation. But what may be the typical source of the dislocations? Probably practically you can say the solidification, because errors in the formation of the perfect crystal lattice is happens during the solidification of the material. And solidification after solidification, the metal the sample is subject to some amount of the dislocations. Another source of the dislocation is the plastic deformation. If you further strain the material, or there is a or if you try to deform the material, so there must be some nucleation and the multiplication of the dislocation happens. So that is better explained in terms of the two basic element theory, that Frank Reed sort of the dislocation, how we can impart, generate the dislocation during the plastic deformation of a material, and or one bowing mechanism also responsible for that. But the hardening mechanism can be better explained, which is started by Taylor in 1934, that the work hardening is due to the dislocation interaction. So basic mechanism of the work hardening is the dislocation interaction. So let us see what are the prediction of the Taylor's theory. It is, as we said, the moving dislocation interact with each other elastically and get trapped. Probably we are trying to explain the elastic deformation here, and that is the assumptions of this theory. Now, trap dislocation give rise to internal stresses that actually increase the stress necessary for deformation. So only consider S dislocation, let us consider only S dislocation and assume there is a uniform distribution of the dislocation, and the spacings between dislocations can be represented in terms of the root of, this is the L probably represented 1 by dislocation density. So if we look into this figure here, if we see that the several dislocations are there and the distance between the two dislocation is L, and this is the elemental length total to similar A and B. The simple case of S dislocation moving from point A to point B over a length small L. Now the effective internal stress caused by this interaction is stress necessary to force two dislocation past each other. So when one dislocation at point A will try to move point B, so the interaction, it will try to, it is not possible to avoid the interaction with the presence of the other dislocations. So presence of the other dislocation and their interaction with this dislocation presence at A during the travel from point A to point B having some effect, or that actually impart some amount of the stress to move from A to B. If we consider it is free from other dislocations, so maybe some minimum amount of stress is necessary to move from A to B, but presence of other dislocation in that path with different orientation actually makes more complicated, or makes it's necessary to large amount of the stress is required to move from A point A to point B. That means presence of other dislocation actually interact to the initiation of the movement of the dislocation from one point to another point, and that is represents the what is the amount of the extra stress is necessary to move from point A to B in the presence of the other dislocations. So of course as a bulk, the presence of the other dislocations, it is better to represents or representation of the so many dislocation or specified zone in terms of the dislocation density rather than individual dislocation. So spacing between these two dislocation, probably between two dislocation, and its average value, it's a, let us consider as capital A. Now consider the simple case of S dislocation from point A to B, and now minimum approach distance of other dislocation is L by 2. So that means between two distance between two dislocation, if we assume the average distance is L, so at least effect of the one dislocation can be half of this. So that is L by 2, and that is called the minimum approach distance of other dislocation is the half of the average distance between the two dislocation, that is capital L by 2. Considering the repulsive force, the shear stress between this between the interaction of the two dislocations, we can represent it in that things that we have discussed when you try to explain the interaction of the dislocations and corresponding the stress field, we represent it in terms of this coordinate x1, x2 and the Burgers vector and the shear modulus G and Poisson's ratio in this case. So now suppose that if we consider x1 is that minimum distance, so basically L by 2, half of the average distance of the dislocation, and if we consider x2 equal to 0, then we can estimate the amount of the shear stress is actually Gb by pi 1 minus nu into L. So that is basically some constant term and Burgers vector and the distance between the two dislocations. So in order to overcome this amount of the shear stress value, yes, shear stress is represented tau equal to sigma b, if you get it, and if you apply that, then we can say the shear stress is actually kb into root over of L, because the distance actually is proportional to the 1 by dislocation density that we have already used that relation. So using that, we can find out the L And if you replace L, so it is say the shear stress is actually proportional to the, depends on the dislocation density and the Burgers vector in this case. Now Orwan's equation states that amount of the shear stress, some constant term, dislocation density, Burgers vector, and the that length between the movement from one point to the point another point. So that L, B and rho. So by combining this relation and Orwan's equation, we can find out shear stress is specifically is a proportional to the amount of the shear strength. So sometimes this relation can also be used to link that the what is the amount of the shear stress required to move the dislocation, which is proportional to the amount of the square root of the amount of the shear strength. So in general, the equation can be written like that. We need to add a frictional term, tau zero, stress required to move the dislocation in the absence of the other dislocation, that means it's an ideal condition, in the absence of the other dislocation, if we introduce that term, that constant term, plus this is the some constant term into this, which is proportional to the amount of the shear strain to the movement of the dislocation from one point to the another point. So this equation actually describes the behavior of the many materials specifically at the large strain amount. So this equation we can use to predict that amount of the shear strain to move the dislocation from one point to another point. So in general, apart from that equation, we can link that finally the amount of the shear stress to move the dislocation and the in terms of the dislocation density, probably we can represent the tau equal to tau 0 plus b into root over of rho. So here tau 0 is specifically base stress to move dislocation in the crystals in the absence of the other dislocation, rho is the dislocation density, and b is a constant term. So this equation probably we can link that the stress to move the dislocation. Now it is obvious if you do the reasoning of this equation, when there is an increment of the dislocation density during in specifically the increment of the dislocation density during the cold work process, in this case there is an amount of the increment of the strain, that means deformation, amount of the deformation, and that actually correlate directly that increment of the shear stress. So if you look into that increment of this dislocation density with the application of the cold work, increment of the shear stress value tau, that means the increment of the shear stress value tau means this is the effect of the strain hardening due to the increment of the dislocation density, and that happens at the plastic deformation of a single crystal or polycrystalline structure. Now this is just for an example, numerical example, to look basically the physical parameter. We can see that shear stress is 1.5, dislocation density is corresponding to 10 to the power 10 1 by meter square, and if we consider tau 0 as a constant term, you can find out the a constant a equal to 10. Okay, now this becomes 100 when dislocation density changes from 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 14. With the change of this amount of the dislocation density, there is a increment of the strain from 1.5 meganewton per meter square to 100. So there is a huge, keeping all other parameters, the constant term remains the same. So that means only practically there is a, with the increment of the number of dislocation density, and that happens is practically there is a huge amount of the increment of the strength level. So that is the physical interpretation of the strain hardening. Now of course other point is there, during the cold war, by increment of the amount of the dislocation density, if the strength level is increased, but at the same time the ductility level actually decreases. So that means material can deform up to certain limit, so that after that it cannot sustain the deformation and it start to creates the fracture at that point. So point is that with the increment of the strength level, there is a decrement of the ductility. That is because of the basic mechanism of the strain hardening in case of single crystal structure and or polycrystalline structure. Now, strain hardening behavior can be explained like that: the stress to cause further plastic deformation, and that can be defined, sometimes use the term the flow stress value, and that actually increases with strain, and that it can be said as the strain hardening. But this happens at dislocations moving in non-parallel slip planes and when they can intersect with respect to each other. Finally, results in an increase in the stress required to cause further plastic deformation, and that mechanism is generally called strain hardening or work hardening. One such mechanism by which the dislocation is immobilized is actually is the Lombard Cottrell barrier. So that strain hardening mechanism is sometimes is better to explain by this mechanism by which the dislocation becomes immobilized. So I am not going into the details discussion of this mechanism of fault strain hardening. Now, if you look into the typical stress strain diagram of a polycrystalline material, so specifically after the necking, there is a sometimes dynamic recovery also happens. So in single crystal experiment, the rate of strain hardening actually decreases with the further straining, and specifically on the stress 3 and after reaching a certain stress level. At this stress level, screw dislocations actually are active for the cross slip, because presence of the screw dislocation actually more prone to the occurrence of the cross slip. So in that case, the resolved shear stress on the new slip plane should be enough for glide, so that when activation of the cross slip actually imparts the dynamic recovery of a specific material, and that happens when it is reaches to the optimum stress level, or maybe after certain stress level the dynamic recovery actually happens. Now in fact, that FCC metals probably having strong correlations between the stacking fault energy and strain hardening exponent. So that's why figure actually represents the relation between the stacking fault energy and the strain hardening coefficient, specifically in case of FCC metals. And here, if we see that with increase of the stacking fault energy, actually the strain hardening coefficient decreases. That means the role of cross slip and the dislocation are actually more relevant to the effect of the strain hardening when you try to incorporate or try to link the what is the effect of the stacking fault energy in the strain hardening mechanism. So low stacking fault energy, in that case work hardening is more persistent, because in the low stacking fault energy the cross slip is actually difficult. When there is a high stacking fault energy, probably in that case cross slip is the more easier to form. So when there is a activation of the cross slip or the occurrence of the cross slip, the probability is more. So in that case there is a chances of the dynamic recovery that actually effectively reduces the strain hardening effect. But dislocation mechanics related to this different work hardening, that means we have already discussed that related to this mechanism, dislocation movement, probably the dislocation basic mechanism, dislocation piles up, cross slip, that we have already discussed on this. So I am not repeating the same thing here again. So with this effect of the strain hardening to impart the strength level of a single crystal or polycrystalline structure, today I can stop here. So next class I will try to explain the other hardening mechanisms and maybe focused on the either single crystal structure as well as the polycrystalline structure. Thank you very much for your kind attention.